Thank you for finding the time to spend a few more minutes with us for this Web Extra. Now, Tripp, you were just saying, as we concluded that last segment, that you wanted to add something more to what Justin was saying in his story.
Well, the question in the previous segment was basically, you know, why some of the stations, you know, or media outlets, the Santa Fe New Mexican picked up on that, but other media outlets maybe haven't picked up on this story. And it's very difficult to do what Justin did. This story has been around for a while, and there's been some hesitance by the source that he named. I think probably Justin can speak for himself, but there probably was a lot of phone conversations and kind of like saying, hey, you know, this is important stuff. I mean, you talk to a source that way to really kind of bring them out. And this is a really, really potentially explosive story. And you have to be really careful with it. And I think maybe that's part of what's going on with, you know, the other media outlets, or it could be something else, frankly. I mean, I don't know.
Well, the response was tremendous. I mean, the language that came from the governor's campaign staff, what was it, bad journalism?
Breathing life into a baseless smear that's already been discredited. Where has it been discredited?
Where? That's one thing as a journalist, I don't know where it's been discredited.
Nowhere. I've asked him, and I think that I've asked him the question directly for since April, at least. Did you guys run license plate numbers through the National Criminal Information Center database or any other criminal law enforcement databases? They're not directly responding to that question. And yes, it is difficult to get a source to go on record, especially, you know, a source who is also a Republican, and I think also fears that retaliation. I think that they're, the kind of response of, I think, the governor and her political advisors have made it a habit to attack whistleblowers. And I think that has had a chilling effect on investigative journalism, really. Okay.
And there's the story. There's two issues there. As a citizen legislator and as a citizen, you know, we wanted to know the rest of the story, and we never saw it. We'd like to be able to know exactly what happened to that, because there's the story itself, and then what happened to that story. How come we can't find out more about it? And it's where you started off, the first segment. Okay, if somebody's given $800,000 to a certain outlet, and somebody else is giving about $25,000, whose story are you going to really run? And that's what bothers, I think, Joe Citizen.
Can I take a step back and just say that in my reporting on governors in a couple of states, what Justin and the representative are talking about is this is not a Republican or a Democrat issue. I've seen Democrats and Republicans here in other states really put the fear of God into people if they come out publicly. And so I just want to take a step back and say this is almost about power as well. It's not just about partisan stuff.
Yeah, I agree. And the story, you know, I had about kind of the Casanova con man story involving Gary King, I think their first response was actually to attack the people who kind of came out about this and brought this story out. And that is a trend. I think that if you are in power and somebody's making an allegation against you, your first response is if you can't discredit that allegation, you have to discredit the source.
I'd like to pick up on something Tripp said, which is that, you know, this is a very difficult story to do, which makes it not very attractive for broadcast media to go out and cover, because it's a difficult thing to do. And in terms of how broadcast media works versus print media, you've got, you know, 30-second pieces, minute-long pieces. It's very difficult to do that kind of work. And so that may be a part of it as well. In terms of whether or not there's anything going on with regards to the networks that they're getting all this advertising revenue from the candidates, and therefore they're not covering particular stories, the candidates have nowhere else to go. They have to broadcast on TV, so it doesn't seem like there's much of an incentive actually for the broadcast networks to not cover the story. Because they're all getting roughly comparable amounts of advertising revenue.
It could be. I mean, certainly we're a long distance from being able to say, and we are clearly not saying in this segment, that there is such a relationship that, you know, you spend a certain amount of money and you can expect some easier coverage. That dynamic, though, I think we all have relationships with money. And right now, for example, in this week as we're going in, there's a lot of money that's going to be spent. There are candidates who have a checkbook out, and they're watching what's on the tube, what's on the websites. And I think it would be naive to think that it makes no difference whatsoever, because they do have relationships with the station management.
Can I say something, too, about the evolution of media in the last 30 years or 25 years that I've been working in it? You've had an explosion of outlets. You have an explosion of money that campaigns can spend. At the same time that you've had, at least in newspaper newsrooms, a kind of like a diminishment of the number of people who actually cover this stuff. I'm not sure about, you know, TV broadcast, but I mean, and some of these issues are, Justin's story is very difficult, but, you know, also issues about poverty here in New Mexico, mm-hmm. or systemic issues, that's very difficult to cover as well. And about broadcast media and this story that Justin did, usually TV media needs someone to be on air talking about that, and that's scary to a source, I think, in a way that maybe it isn't scary to, like, you didn't necessarily have a video of her, I think.
No.
And I think that's part of it as well. I mean, there are a lot of factors here on this.
Well, let's talk briefly. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to bring up the part that we had talked about a little bit off air, but it's worthwhile now, and that is we, the legislators and people that run for office, have to turn in reports on their money being spent. We have to turn in one on Thursday of this week, and then after that, the election's over. So, but the money that's going to be spent is, we've been talking in the past, it's what's going to be happening in the real near future. And that's where I talked about the definition of the candidate. It's going to be, you know, just absolute chaos out there when it talks about this person is, you did this, and then the person's going to try to respond. We only have a couple of hours in which to do it. All that money that we thought was already spent, I think we haven't seen the money that's going to get spent within the next couple of days.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, and to that end, and we just have a couple of more minutes, but there's one story I want you to touch on, the behavioral health story. You all, your organization just published an email regarding the kind of what looked like a proposal for the takeover of the behavioral health system. On that issue, what kind of coverage do you see that getting in the marketplace?
Well, I mean, let me give a shout out. New Mexico In Depth did something, but also the Santa Fe New Mexican, they also wrote about this. You know, the behavioral health story is a very complicated story, which means right there, as we're talking about this, that excludes some outlets. They're just not going to write about this because it's, you have to have a certain knowledge of how what the story is, the mechanics and stuff like this. The email that we published for your viewers basically is an email from Optum Health, which was the overseer, oversight, administrator for the state of the behavioral health system. Behavioral health refers to people who are getting drug addiction treatment or mental illness treatment from providers. We have previously, New Mexico had previously reported that the state had reached out to some of the Arizona providers in late November, early December 2012. The audit started in, I think, February, I think, mm-hmm. of 2012.
Early.
What happened was Optum found some, they did some analysis of some of these providers and found what they thought were some problematic facts. And in October, I think it was October 25th, 2012, Optum reached out to the state and said, look, we have, you know, scenario one, you know, where we can have people take over, I think, as I'm recalling the email, take over, at least help these providers. Or option two is, you know, we're over in Arizona, Optum Health, and we know some really good providers over there, and maybe we can actually kind of bring, at least think about bringing them over. I don't know the significance of the email. It's just interesting.
Okay. Well, we're almost out of time, and I'd like to leave it with you, Professor Krebs. Now, it is, I think, even a little comforting that although on the one hand it seems like things have really changed with this ad spending, but you're taking a longer view. What are the things for us to watch for going forward to see how money and the changes in law are impacting the process?
Well, I think, you know, It's critical for citizens to watch ads carefully and to listen to what's being communicated, to really not turn the channel, but to listen to what's being communicated, and to pay attention at the end of the ad to the who's paying for it. so that citizens can be start to get in the mode of separating out direct candidate ads, candidate expenditures for ads for themselves, versus spending and ads for outside groups. Because it's chaotic because people don't know who's behind what, and they don't know who is saying what message on the air. And so that's what makes it very difficult, I think, for regular voters to evaluate the candidates, what they stand for, what they might do in office. So that's one thing. I think the other thing is just to try and get more sort of more sunlight on who's contributing to these groups. I think that's the most important thing, is to find out who's behind many of these ads. That's the thing that I think is fundamentally wrong with the law and the state of policy in this area. I have mixed feelings about sort of, you know, limits on contributions over, but I want to know who's contributing. So I think that's the most important thing moving forward.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate you all staying a few minutes extra.